broadcasting currently on YouTube live around the world directly from here, Casablanca, Morocco. Big round of applause for the city of Casablanca, who has hosted us here generously. Right, Sean?
Absolutely. Yeah.
So go ahead, Sean.
I tried couscous.
Oh, you tried couscous day.
It's couscous day, right? Friday?
Couscous day, right? All right, so just for context, for those of us who are joining us brand new, my name is Buddy Scalera, and I am here today to talk about writing comic books. I am a comic book writer, probably best known for Deadpool. We did some live illustrations with the work that I've done on the Avengers. And I'm joined here by my good friend, Sean Chen, who is, we just found out, almost 30 years in the comic book business. Sean, for the live audience out there on the internet, talk about some of the titles that you have worked on.
Most of it was for Marvel. I started out at Valiant Comics, but moved on to Marvel. And over there, I did Iron Man for 3 years, which is probably what I'm most known for. After that, 2 years on Wolverine. And then after that, X-Men, Avengers, and some Spider-Man and Nova, and most of their characters.
Yeah, so Sean has been... Oh, yeah, go ahead. Do the clap. Go ahead. I saw you want to do it. That's right. Anytime you want to burst into applause, it's okay. Okay. So the reason that we are here today is to bring you some guests that might not have been able to join us this week in Casablanca, but maybe in the future, if they feel really loved by you guys, they might join us. So today we're going to be speaking with someone that I knew as an editor at Marvel Comics, but also as one of the most impactful writers of Daredevil. And his storylines were so impactful that many of those storylines were mentioned in the Daredevil television series on Netflix, right?
Yep.
And now he has been invited back some 25 years later to write Daredevil again. So he is the current writer of Daredevil. He is formerly the writer of Nick Fury, Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., Punisher, Spider-Man, Elektra. He did a crossover between Daredevil and Batman, and he also did Midnight Suns, which you probably know better with the Ghost Rider character. So if we can give a big round of applause, we're going to bring Dan D.G. Chichester here to you from New York right now.
Buddy, Sean, I'm amazed to be here. This is amazing. I cannot believe this. Thank you guys for having me on. Hello to everybody there in Morocco. What an amazing experience this is.
Dan, these people have packed the room. They're standing room only, and they are so excited to talk with you. Dan, could you just give us the 30-second origin story of how you broke into comics?
Well, of course, it involved a radioactive spider, as all good origin stories do. I was bitten by a radioactive spider. I became an assistant editor at Epic Comics, which was a division of Marvel that handled creator-owned comics. From there, I moved up to becoming an editor. And then, as you so eloquently put, Buddy, I became the writer of Nick Fury, Agent of S.H.I.E.L.D., which was a great place to play out all my spy fantasies. And from there, became the writer on Daredevil. Moving it through the first time that Daredevil really took down the Kingpin in the Fall of the Kingpin story, which we called Last Rites, Fall from Grace, which was a big, epic, crazy story, which pit him up against many, many insane villains and introduced what became known as the Black Armor costume, which lasted for a little while and is now back in this mini series that you mentioned, Buddy. After many years working in comics, I moved out of comics, and now this new mini series starts next week. And I see applause. That's great.
So, Dan, they were very excited. Just for some context, I listed some of the comic books that you have written. I'm sure you probably have forgotten how many exactly you've written, but because you've written so many... How many comics do you suppose that you have written for Marvel Comics over your career, not including what you're currently writing this month?
If I was to total up all the issues and all the variants of it, you know, it's several hundred, in that range. I mean, many other people have written many, many more, but I've hit many of the major characters beyond the ones you mentioned, Captain America. You know, was a favorite with a team up with the Punisher at one point. So between annuals, regular series, mini series, specials, and so forth, numbers into the hundreds of comics,
wow,
which I'm very excited to have done.
Now, Dan, you are, so I just want you guys to be aware that in a minute we're going to turn to the audience. So if anybody has any questions, get your question ready. It might help if you stood up. This way we can see you because the lights are very bright. So if you have a question, don't be afraid to stand up. This might be your first and only chance to talk to the famous DG Chichester. Dan.
Him. You, that sounds so dreadful.
No, I mean it in a, yeah, that did sound pretty bad, didn't it, John?
There's not much left of me.
There's not much. So, Dan, you were invited back because of the unbelievable story run that you did on Daredevil. You've been invited back to do Daredevil again. What does it feel like to come back to this character after so many years and having written such an important storyline to now come back and be asked to write yet another important storyline where you bring back what is called the black or armored costume? Can you talk about what that's like for you?
Yeah, it's crazy. I never expected to come back to work on Daredevil. I figured my run was done, which was fine. I had had a great experience and had a chance to tell great stories. But to have this invitation really put me back in a really interesting mindset, because I knew the character and I knew what to do with him, but I'm a much different writer now than I am then. And I think I'm a better writer. So coming back into this, I had a very much more mature, confident, direction of what I could do with the character. And the editors were very encouraging to try out some different things. They said, bring back, you know, maybe some things that are familiar. They liked that sort of sense of making some connection, but they said, push it up against some new villains, new situations. I gave them some crazy things and they were really smart about giving me notes on it, how to improve it and make it more effective as a story. So it's knowing, as I said at one point, I know how to jump off a rooftop because I've done it many times in stories, but I wasn't exactly sure this was going to land because of everything that's going on now with who I am and how I write. And that was a great place to be, because it's exciting to try something new. So as familiar as this is, it's also very new. And that's what's so special for me.
Hi, this is Sean Chen. I have a question for you. Who is Alan Smithy?
Oh, this is a deep cut, Sean. Okay. When my first run on Daredevil unfortunately ended in a bad situation. There was a change in editorial offices, and I was removed from the title midway through a story that I was writing, which, you know, happens, but it didn't happen in the greatest of ways. Alan Smithy is a name that film directors, I don't know if they still do, but they used to use when a film project that they were on went badly. And then they didn't want to take credit for what the movie had turned out to be. So instead of putting their real name on it, they would put Alan Smithy on it. I had gone to film school. I was a big fan of films. I had hoped to move into film direction at some point in my own way. So when I was taken off the book midway through a storyline, I said that I didn't want my name, my credits on it, because I felt the storyline wasn't going to be as good as I wanted it to be. So I told them I wanted to put Alan Smithy on there. So for many years, people would come and say, well, who's Alan Smithy? And you know, what does he do? And I said, well, Alan did one story in comics and probably is not coming back. So although a fan did come up to me recently and did have me autograph a book as Alan Smithy, which I thought was a pretty funny bit of business.
Cool.
So, Dan, you just mentioned something really important. We have noticed from coming here to Casablanca, Dan, this is a very cinematically rich city.
Yes.
And obviously, films have been shot here, obviously, most mm-hmm. famously Casablanca, but most recently, John Wick 3 had scenes here in Casablanca and in Morocco. You know, you mentioned that you are a film student.
Right.
What did you learn as a film student and as a filmmaker that helped inform what you did as a comic book creator?
Film is visual, and comics are visual, and that's a great question. And as a film student, when I first started making films when I was 18, 19 in film school, I had this mindset of almost like a theater. You know, my professor accused me of what he said, you know, having a tendency to shoot things like you were in a theater. Like I had a set camera, one place, everything happened out in front of it, like it was a performance. And what I learned in film school was that you're approaching everything from a visual. The camera is moving, it's in different places, it's coming in closer to capture emotion, it's going up high to make things look small or character look small. It's shooting up at a character's situations to make things more dramatic. You're changing the lighting from something very happy to something very angry or something very fearsome and dreadful. And these are keys that I took into comics, because every time I look at a comic page, and if anybody there in the audience is interested in creating comics and thinking about this from a writing point of view, what you're doing is you're trying to create that situation where an artist can then take what you're thinking visually and then interpret that in the best way. So I was always thinking, and still do think, in the visual moments. What's the beat? Where's the camera? What's the next close-up or medium close-up or dramatic angle? And what is fitting in that frame or that panel on the comic page at any given time in order to catch the reader's attention and lead them from panel to panel, so that you can hand that off to an artist and that artist can then feel inspired to take that to the next level with their own talent.
Now, that's a great answer. And just remember, for those of you who just joined, if you have any questions for Dan, we are here for you. Just stand up and we will take your question next. We're very happy to take your question and ask it for Dan. But, you know, Sean, you have worked on many of the same characters that Dan has worked on, or DG Chichester, Dan has worked on. Well, that's his writing name. But what do you do, Sean, specifically to what Dan was just saying, to take a script, which mm-hmm. is just words on a page, and make it visual that will help our audience to understand how you go from words on a page to something that feels real in the real space?
Well, yeah, that's a good question. Usually, I'm trying to imagine exactly what you have in your head, and I'm really in a service position where I kind of I'm trying to realize your vision. You talk about being a director, but I guess you know, I wish you could be more of a director. I think that kind of falls on my shoulders, and that always makes me very nervous, because when I get the story back to you and you get to put the dialogue on it, I can't imagine it would look that much like what you had in your head. You know, if there is a way that you can be the director, and then I know when you're directing, you actually have to also rely on actors and their performance, and it's a collaboration. Mm-hmm. But you know, I always, when there is a big name writer, like Chris Claremont or yourself, and I always feel very nervous that they have something in their head, and I just know that I'm not going to capture it exactly. And then quite often they always tell me that it kind of sometimes exceeded, or I saw it in a different way, and that back and forth is kind of how we do comics, I guess.
Can I respond to that, buddy?
Dan, we're up. You're up.
Yeah, Sean. I mean, working with somebody like yourself in that way, I think, is the most exciting thing about a comic. I know a lot of comics nowadays are probably written in more of this full script, almost screenplay style, like where a writer might say, you know, page one, panel one, here's a description, here's all the dialogue, you know, and so forth. I really like the old school way of doing it, what was called the Marvel style, where I would describe in a plot sort of way, a lot of detail, but, you know, page one to two, page three to five, and then describe a lot of things with maybe some sprinkles of dialogue, you know, in there that had come to me along the way. Giving that over to somebody like yourself is the magic, because yes, I'd like to sort of see what I'm seeing in my head, but I know that you're going to plus that many times over. So when I get that back from a talented individual and it's not exactly what I saw in my head, it's actually better. It's kind of like in an organic way. It's yes, that's what I wanted, but I didn't see all the details. And then that will change maybe sometimes the approach to the dialogue that is written, the word balloons and the captions, in a really exciting way on this series that I'm working on right now with Netho Diaz. There were scenes where I thought I had the perfect dialogue and I'd sort of written it into the plot, But when he came back with his pages, it inspired better things, things I no longer had to handle in words because they were already there in the images. You know, young Matt Murdock, you know, I said, oh, he's really nervous, and I'm figuring I have to write some, you know, nervous dialogue to indicate that. His body language and all the little details he's got about him, like sort of pulling on his shirt and the way he is, right away, it's there. It's all there in the image. So I can then go somewhere else with the words, which is real magic. Comics are so collaborative. And that's, I think, the real beauty of it is working with your partners, too.
Interesting. Yeah. I think, well, I'm wondering if you're, are you working in the full script now? Because I know it was done differently before. The full script is kind of like the standard now. So I'm just wondering
right.
whether you're changing the way you work.
I had thought I was going to do this full script. I had been working with the editors. You know, we'd done a sort of a what I would call a beat sheet where we sort of, you know, broke down the elements of the story. Then I kind of went on to more of a plot just to kind of expand on elements. And there was a little bit of time to do that. And then I had to make some changes in the structure of the story and the flow of the story. And I was still working the plot way in my head, I thought, because modern comics are written, as you said, in this full script way. I thought it was going to come back to me and I was going to have to do the full script. Instead, they just sent it right to Netho as the plot, which was a big surprise. All of a sudden, I opened my email and there's the first 5-6 pages. And so suddenly this old school retro story is now being created in this old school retro way, which, again, to me, has worked out so much better than if I had to go through and write it in, you know, page one, panel one, everything scripted, panel two, everything scripted, which, you know, I could have done, but the things he's doing with the pages, or he's opening things up or maybe closing things down in terms of the pacing and what's on the page, is just making it so much more exciting for, I think, him and me.
Now, speaking of exciting, guys, we're about to go into the next phase of the conversation with Dan. Dan, we're going to be playing a little game that you didn't know we'd be playing. But it's going to be fine. You're going to love it. Before we move into that, does anybody have any questions for Dan D.G. Chichester, the writer of Daredevil? You have a question. Come on up, and we're going to give you one of the microphones. You want to do that? Oh, he's got a microphone. There you go. And then can you just stand right there in the center, in the light? That's it. Stand on one foot. One foot. No, stand on one foot and hop. No, I'm kidding. Say your name and your age.
Hello. My name is Eamon. I'm 20 years old. I just want to tell you that I was always fascinated by Daredevil since my childhood. And my question is, what inspired you to write such a great story as Daredevil?
Oh, well, that's a great question, and thank you for asking it. I think what inspired me were the people that had worked on it before. I was very much inspired by some of the people who preceded me on the title. I knew the character, but I think I really got the charge out of it, especially when Frank Miller, you know, dug into the character, and then Ann Nocenti followed him on the book afterwards. Different writers telling different types of stories, but it enriched the character in such a big way for me that it made me more aware of him and more excited for him. And when the opportunity actually opened on the book, when Ann Nocenti was leaving, I didn't really think I was ready for it. A good friend of mine encouraged me to make the pitch to the editor to try out for the book, but I thought, man, I'm not ready for this yet. But the pitch I wrote apparently got the editor's attention enough that he took a chance on me and then teamed me up with Lee Weeks, who was just a magic pairing. I think, again, that was an indication of the magic of comics, where we suddenly had two folks who were really interested in the character and really interested in making a difference. And we played off each other very well. We played to each other's strengths to get to that story that we did, where we did the fall of the Kingpin.
That was a good question. Good question. All right, we'll still have time after the game show with Dan, but does anybody have any other questions before we get started? You do? All right, sounds good. We have a question here in the front row.
Yeah.
we have a question there. She's got the mic. Thank you. Thanks for coming up. What's your name and what's your age?
My name is Shawqi. I'm 35.
All right. Yes, ask your question.
Hello. My question is, I want to be bitten by a radioactive spider too and become a comic book writer like you. So my question is, how can I convince an editor that to publish my work?
You're a writer, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Did you hear that question, Dan?
Yes. Okay. Yes, I did. The spider is obviously the easier way to go. Some editors are tougher than spiders. And as a writer, you have a tougher road to go. There's no question. An artist has an easier time of it, and big quotes around that, because when they go up to an editor, visually, immediately, they can see the skill, the excitement, the ability to tell a story or not tell a story, and make a judgment very quickly. Writers, editors have to lean into more. They have to read your page. So two things, you know, come to mind to help you out. One is, as you go to editors in whatever you're doing, proposals, sample stories, tailor your writing to that editor. If you're trying to get on the Hulk or X-Men or Spider-Man or even a lesser character, or not as well-known a character, I should say, don't give the Hulk editor Spider-Man story. Don't give the Spider-Man editor an X-Men story. Tailor your approach to who you're going for. It's going to make a big difference, because then they're going to be zoned in on what you do. And what I would really recommend for you, though, most importantly, is find an artist that you can team up with in terms of doing some samples. Even if it's a few pages, right here in probably this room, there are artists that you could meet. If there are conventions that you can go to, you can meet them there. But getting a few pages done alongside an artist is going to help accelerate an editor's looking at your story and appreciating what you can do, because now it has a visual element that they can appreciate much more quickly. And then they're going to be more excited about leaning into your longer form writing and your proposals. And if you have any opportunity to talk to an editor at a convention or on email or on social rather, and they give you an opening to say, yeah, we'll take your proposal, we'll take your idea, but here's my conditions. I only want one page, right? For example, I want one page description of your story. Stick with that. There were many times when I was an editor when I would say I need a one-page proposal and somebody would send me a 50-page proposal. And their cover note would say, hey, this is so great. I know once you read the 50 pages, you'll know this is better than one page. But I wouldn't read it, because they sort of already said that you can't sort of follow instructions. So those three ideas, I think, might help you out. And I hope this advice is useful.
Yeah, this is great. Great question, too. All right, so Dan, we're going to play a little game, and we will leave time for additional questions. So we're going to pull up the PowerPoint and the first slide. So Dan, I am in control of the PowerPoint right now, and what we're going to ask Dan to do is share a memory or a thought based on this comic book cover. So starting with this, Dan, give us your thoughts on what we've just pulled up here on the screen. You can see this, right?
I can sort of see it behind you through the lights. That's the Black Armor cover, right? That's the Mark Bagley. There I go. That's better. This first time I saw this, blown away. I hadn't known that Mark Bagley was going to work on this. How exciting to finally see a Mark Bagley image on something that I'm working on. I thought it was terrific. I love the, Daredevil appearing from the swirls of smoke just fit this whole tone that we're bringing him back in this costume. Which had sort of been dismissed and kind of forgotten for a while. So it really evoked the mystery and the excitement of him back in the scenes. I wish it was a water tower instead of the chimneys.
So that's the only thing I would change. Just for context, Dan, this is the new Daredevil story that you are currently writing. Is this available yet in stores and online?
No, this releases next Wednesday, November 22nd. This will be available in stores at least in the U.S. and certainly online, I believe.
Wow, that's pretty good. Round of applause for that. That's really good. Dan, with that in mind, this storyline will be how many issues?
This is 4 issues. The first issue is 30 pages, and then the following ones are 20 pages, so it'll be a 90-page story altogether.
Wow, that's terrific. And what, without giving away too much, what characters might they expect to see in some of the pages of your upcoming story?
Well, we threw him up against some tougher villains, some villains I don't think he had confronted before. There's some great action with Hobgoblin, with Sabretooth, or two that I know that have come forward. So those are some pretty exciting scenes. And Daredevil and Matt Murdock are drawn into this mystery of vanishing people within Hell's Kitchen. So he has to investigate where are they going, what's happening to them. And of course, it's a lot of no good, and it's going to threaten literally all of Hell's Kitchen in a somewhat over-the-top adventure. We keep turning the dial up more and more and more to really effectively play out this type of 90s-style adventure that we were trying to kind of create.
So I'm going to put Sean on the spot. This is a pretty incredible cover with some really, if I might say, daring colors, right? You don't usually see yellow bricks, but because of the color of the costume, I would imagine that the colorist and the artist had to make some serious choices to make this image so impactful. Sean, do you want to just talk very briefly about how to make an impactful cover and why this cover is so impactful?
It's kind of obvious. It's very impactful. It's a full figure of the character. Also, he has red accents on him, and I guess that's the reason why the bricks are not red. Still kind of dilute the character, and red and green are kind of are polar opposites, so this, it really does pop in all the right ways. So I think this is a fantastic job by a true veteran of the industry.
Yeah, real master of the craft. Okay, so we're going to ask you for the next one. Dan, next cover, give us your thoughts, your memories about this particular cover.
Oh, my God. I think that's the first issue of Daredevil I worked on. Is that 292? I think that's I mean, it was literally the first issue. So what a great, you know, and of course the Punisher's bigger than Daredevil in his own comic, which is kind of funny. But you know, I was right into this with Lee Weeks. So we were both young and we were both hungry and we were both eager to make our mark at all, but certainly on Daredevil. So to get a chance to play not only with Daredevil, but the Punisher, who was extraordinarily popular in the 90s, you know, this was unbelievable. For me, this was just a total thrill, is this happening, you know, kind of moment. And every time I would see something from Lee, it was always just a really dynamic, you know, style. If you know Lee Weeks' art, he's never sort of faltered from his style. He's just gotten better and better at it. But even here, right away, you get a sense of dramatic action, but also that feels so authentic, right? It feels like it's really happening, I think. He's got that real ability to conjure street-level authenticity in really incredible action.
Yeah, I would agree. With Lee Weeks, I read some of your the books you did together. He always has Daredevil in mid-flight. I mean, like, you would think the guy could fly. And this dramatic up angle, I mean, again, another veteran of the industry was really great. And I think that the two of you just made these like roller coaster ride comics and this cover is an example of that. And your entire run together was just, you turn the pages and it'd be breathtaking. My heart would skip a beat when I'm reading it, and it really did feel the action.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Wow, Sean, thank you so much.
Yeah, and I think, Sean, something we've talked about earlier in different parts of the show, the use of negative space. Lee could have drawn buildings in the background, but because he wanted to draw the eye to Daredevil flying, or not flying, leaping toward the Punisher, He used a lot of negative space. Is that how, as an artist, you draw the eye?
Right. Well, see, Daredevil is small in this. This is probably that era when the Punisher was in every book and that made the sales go up.
So
Daredevil is kind of small in this, but you can still make it work if you put him in a nice clear spot and have a nice contrasting color around him. Your eye still goes to that, and he's right underneath his logo, and this is a Daredevil cover in every respect, even though there's so much going on in it.
Yeah, it's a really incredible cover. Dan, ready for the next one?
All right. Let me see what that. Oh, wow. Okay, so Night Stalkers. This is what you were talking about with the Midnight Suns, buddy. So for folks who don't know this, Ghost Rider was so popular that Marvel decided to do a whole run of Supernatural books. So there was The Darkhold. There was Morbius. And there was Night Stalkers, and then Ghost Rider and Spirits of Vengeance. So Ghost Rider actually spawned all these other titles, and all these characters would kind of group together to fight supernatural evil. And here, this was an opportunity to take three characters that had never really teamed up before in exactly this way, and I've been charged with figuring out how do they work together. So while I didn't create the characters, I got to create a whole new team around them. And Ron Garney was, again, here's another artist who you look at his work then and now and you still know it's Ron Garney, but he's just become more and more robust and mature and exciting as he's kind of continued here. And here in his earlier days, what a chance to work with a top-notch artist and creating just such a charge of a cover. Not only was it exciting to see these three characters sort of poised in motion, but I think what he did here is that sense that everything's happening just right off here. What are they attacking? That's drawing you into the story, and really drew me in as well. I want to turn that cover to find out what are they fighting against within.
Right, Sean, that's what it is. It created that imperative to turn the page.
Right, yeah, you're kind of dropped in the middle of something that you really have to find out what the results are. Yeah, this is a great cover because I noticed the title first because it's so bright yellow. And then it kind of has like a cyclical feel to it where it kind of leads your eye around. And it's a busy cover with a lot of stuff on there, but I think it still works as a composition as a whole.
Hey, Dan, you're right. You know, this is a very Garney cover, but he's become even more Garney with time.
Yes, he has.
Is that a verb? I think it is.
It is now.
Real quick, I mean, for those of you who are not familiar with Night Stalkers, drop a few character names in there. I think Blade made appearances.
Blade is one of the main characters. Frank Drake, who was one of the descendants of Dracula. Hannibal King was the third character, who was also, you know, somebody who had been affected by vampirism. So all three of them had been affected by vampires. Their lives had been ruined by the supernatural. And what they decided was that while they had supernatural powers and abilities and science, is they decided the supernatural was so awful that their mission was to destroy the supernatural. So imagine the Ghostbusters on super steroids. And that's what these guys were when they teamed up together.
All right, Dan, we are going to show you the next covers. And don't forget, everybody, we're going to be doing questions right after we complete. I think we're down to the second to last or the last slide. Oh, we are back to Midnight Suns. What a cover. I don't even know who did that. Look like Texiera cover, yeah, doesn't it?
It looks like one. It's a fiery burst. This was fun because this is a collection. You know, Midnight Suns Unlimited was a collection of stories of all the Midnight Suns. So this wasn't just me. This was part of the team up. And we had such a great group of creators working together initially to kind of create that Midnight Suns. And I think this was probably the first annual type of thing that had all of them featured within. So I think for me, especially looking at it now, there's a little bit of just nostalgia bringing me back to that sense of what a great team up of folks to work with. And again, creating a world, because the reason that all these supernatural characters got together hadn't been mapped out until we sat down and we did it and we threw these ideas around and we beat our heads against the wall and ultimately came up with the reasons and the villains and such.
Yeah, I remember. I remember enjoying these. I always liked the satanic and hell-like characters that Marvel did. Got one more here for you. And then we're going to take it. We're almost done with the slides. We're going to take questions. So everybody, get your questions ready. Dan, I have to tell you, you can't see it from here, but there is a line. There's a one in, one out rule, and there's literally a line of people who are waiting for the opportunity.
Awesome. I'm here to answer whatever they want.
All right, Wolverine.
What a wild, wild opportunity this was to work on Wolverine specifically. I'd used Wolverine in some stories, but when the Wolverine office called me, Bob Harris had called me and said, you know, hey, Larry Hama needs a break, or he needs to catch up on some stuff, whatever it was. We need a two-issue, fill-in. Would you be interested? And yes. Yes, couldn't get out of my mouth fast enough. So it was just wild to play with the character that I had admired, and to see this cover, which not only featured a Wolverine in his, you know, usual very dramatic pose, but this character Terror that I had created, which was a sort of a boogeyman assassin, you know, alongside him, was just, again, an over the top feeling. I know that I was so lucky in so many of the folks I got teamed up with, and seeing visuals like this for the first time, it was always a kind of a pinch myself moment. I never took it for granted. And still don't to this day.
That's pretty cool. Sean, you got a call from the Wolverine office as well, right? I just like that you call it the Wolverine office.
Oh, it was. Yeah, it was like the CIA.
Yeah, I did Wolverine for 2 years. And it was a lot of fun. It's a great character to be on. I think I drew half of him with a yellow and blue costume, and the other half of the run was the black leathers.
Mm-hmm.
And this is the better costume, by the
this
way.
Is the this is the classic.
Yeah, yeah. Yellow's fun.
All right, West Coast Avengers, Dan. We're almost to the end, and we're going to be asking
you. Oh, my God.
Get your questions
ready.
Oh,
my God.
Well, talk to us about West Coast Avengers.
As you can see, buddy, from the cover copy, and Sean, this is, I believe, and it's not up for me right now, buddy, but I remember this one, you know, so much. It's their greatest battle ever, I believe it says right there. So that really says it all. This is hysterical because this is one of the first major Marvel titles that I worked on. It was a fill-in issue that I wrote with Margaret Clark, a woman I co-wrote a number of projects with. And so we never thought this story was going to run. An inventory story, for folks who don't know, is when editors commission a story, they have it written, sometimes they have it drawn, they just keep it to the side in case the schedule of the regular team slips. And if they go off schedule, they don't want the book to go off schedule, so they'll slot the inventory story in to make up for the time that's lost. So this was what this was. We had written the story. We never thought it was going to run, and luckily it did. So I believe this may have been, this or Solo Avengers was the first time I had a real Marvel title, not things I'd done for Epic or an associated title. So it's a completely ridiculous story, but at the same time, to see it there and to have that cover copy is something I get a lot of joy out of.
A lot of fun out of. I think we have one more slide here. Pull that slide up for us. Now, we know you didn't write this one, Dan, but you had played some role in it.
Oh, my God. Well, Gru the Wanderer, Sergio Aragonés, one of the most amazing artists of all time. This is his version of Conan, for folks who don't know. And if you don't know, run out and get it now. It's one of the funniest, consistently funniest comics ever written. Gru is a bumbling barbarian, and I was the editor on it for a run while I was at Epic. Very privileged to work with Sergio and his team, Mark Evanier. The book really came in complete. It wasn't a heavy editorial ask. You know, you check it through, you would make sure they were paid on time, but they were total professionals. And I guess I impressed them enough that I'm reading through this one issue, and suddenly I turn the page and I come across this gag where people are telling Gru, who's a bit of an idiot, you know, you are the Prince of Chichester. You are the Prince of Chichester. And it makes him have to repeat it because they're trying to con a kingdom into believing that he's royalty. And so I guess Mark and Sergio thought my name was ridiculous enough to turn it into a gag. And now it wasn't only in that issue. It continued on for, it would keep popping up. It may be a running gag to this day, that the phrase "You are the Prince of Chichester" would continue to pop up in Grudem. So I've got that going for me, which is pretty nice.
That's thank you, Dan. Round of applause for Dan sharing his memories. Dan, there is literally a wrestling match here in the audience about who gets to ask you the question first. So we have two people with questions. Get ready. So state your name. Are you willing to stand up?
Yeah.
Okay, stand up. Say your name and your age, and then you can ask Dan Chichester anything you want.
I will say my name, but not my age.
Okay, fair enough.
I'm Hakima.
Hakima.
And with my kids today. And I have a question for our friend in New York. Yes?
Yes.
New York?
Yes.
Did you acquire that laugh by working on comics, or it's the other way around?
That laugh, that sort of like chuckle, like, you know, in between things. I like to think, and Buddy's known me enough and seen me through enough stressful situations. I think bringing humor to it, anything you're doing, is important. So it didn't come out of comics. I think I've always seen a funny side to things, sometimes a darkly funny side to situations. Even though I've written a lot of very dark comics and a very, as Buddy said, some of them are very satanic and crazy and intense. But generally, I like to think that I have a pretty good sense of humor. So that laugh is just something that I enjoy projecting to keep my energy up and hopefully you know, see many sides to a situation.
Yeah, good question.
Is it annoying? I'm sorry. I hope it's not annoying.
No, I can tell you. I in New York, I worked in an office with Dan, and sometimes you could hear that laugh, and you knew exactly where Dan was in the office. So, second question. What's your name and how old are you?
Hi, my name is Aiden. I'm 10
years old. Keep the microphone up.
Hi, my name is Aiden. I'm 10 years old. I was asking a question. Would you create Spider-Man number 3, Miles Morales?
Aiden, it's nice to meet you. Or is the question, did I create Miles Morales?
No.
Is that the question?
No. I will ask. I'm asking you if you're gonna create Miles Morales, Spider-Man number 3, the movie.
Oh man, that would be amazing. But I don't have any control of that. They didn't give me that control yet. So that will probably be some other folks who bring Miles Morales into Spider-Man 3, and that would be a thrill, right? To see that character take an even bigger role. Than he has in some of the you know, the animated features. So let's cross our fingers that happens in the next movie.
Great question. Thank you so much. You can have a seat. All right, so we got another question here. Oh, we got two questions here. Looks like this side of the room. You guys are underrepresented over here. We got two more over here, and then two more over here.
Hello. My name is Eunice, and I'm 19. I inspired to be a comic book artist. So I recently got into comics. I used to consume Marvel content as in the format of games and comics. And I want to ask you guys, how does the writer bear the risk of disappointing loyal fans by taking a different take on a specific character? So like the Ultimate Spider-Man run. They took another path for the Spider-Man character by making him young.
Dan, you want to take this?
Yeah, I mean, that's an amazing question. That's a really, really intense question. Here's the thing I would say to that. As a writer, and probably any, you know, creator, Sean, you may agree with this, but I'm going to start just from the writer point of view. You have to follow where the character tells you that it wants to go. And by that I mean, if you're really into a character, if you've really invested yourself into thinking about him or her, and doing your best and putting your best into the work, ultimately I think that character starts to speak through you. You're not like forcing him or her into a situation. It's really kind of going in a very natural kind of creative flow. And if it's taking you into different directions or telling you, no, I want to do this, you're going to get the best possible story if you follow that creative flow, even if it is going to, quote unquote, disappoint fans. That's what's really going to make it work. When it doesn't work for me is when you try to artificially, you know, insert things, or you try to just kind of please somebody. Oh, the fans are going to like this, so I'm going to write a story that I don't really want to write just to sort of do it because it's going to get across. To me, that always feels very artificial. And I think ultimately, while readers might nod their heads and say, oh, yeah, great. You know, Daredevil's like, you know, fighting the Kingpin again for the 19th time, and they're just going to have a standoff and nothing's going to happen because that's what we've done before and everybody's liked it, is, as I said, it doesn't really set true. Now, sometimes editorial and company edicts in the bigger companies, you know, may say, we have to do a story like this, and you have to sort of follow that along. But I think in the same way, you then need to figure out how to do it the best for yourself. And even if it takes you in a different direction than what you think the fans are going to do, by being true to the character, you're going to create a story that is going to be stronger. And I think ultimately, readers are going to respond positively to that.
Yeah, good question. Good question.
Great question.
And I will add, as a writer, you never plan to tell a bad story, but sometimes it happens, right, Dan? Sometimes it happens. You want to stand up?
Hello.
Hello.
My name is Leila. I'm 28. I have two questions. The first question is about will be another version of Iron Man. Also, it's called to be Iron Woman, the daughter of Iron Man. And my second question about Batman, I love Batman and also Joker. I ask if it will be a relationship between Batman and Joker in the future version. And thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for the question.
Buddy, could you repeat that question? I didn't hear all of it.
Yeah, she was very interested in knowing about future versions of Iron Man and Iron Man's family potentially having a daughter, right? And then we'll get into the second part, which is similar with Batman and Batman relationships and Batman family as well, because I know that you have done some Batman writing. Did we catch that correctly?
بالنسبة للسؤال الثاني in Arabic was تكون علاقة ما بين شوكر وما بين باتمان in necklace it's called to be a relationship between Batman and Joker Joker. Have a problem in pronunciation for this reason I don't say good and I'll ask if will be a relationship between Batman and Joker because I love this cover and also okay دابا قلت لك واش تقدر تكون
would there be
Joker وما بين Batman
would there be a relationship between Batman and Joker
في المستقبل
Yeah, I'm trying to understand.
I think you know she was asking whether there will be a kind of relationship between Joker and Batman in the future. That was her question, right?
Interaction, not relationship.
No, she said.
Yeah,
she said relationship.
Oh no, I think I got it. I think I got it. Okay.
All right, go ahead.
Do I get a prize?
You get two
Do I
prizes.
Get a prize?
Yeah.
Do I get a prize?
You will get a sticker.
Okay. No, yeah, sticker. I want to.
So, Dan, we're going to repeat it here because I think...
Yes, I think I got it. No, I think if I got it, I think it's interesting that she thinks, would it be possible to ever have Joker come to Batman's side and become sort of a good doer and join Batman on a mission to do good? And I think I got it.
Yeah.
My stickers, please.
He deserves a sticker.
So you get a sticker.
Yes.
So, Dan, what are your thoughts on this?
You know, there's classic storytelling where the villain teams up with the hero at some point or another. And I would imagine there has probably been a story somewhere along the way where as antagonistic and at odds as the Joker and Batman are, right? They are matter and antimatter in their own way. There is also that, you know, that situational thing that we've always heard, like one exists because the other exists. You know, the Joker said, you know, you made me possible. So I'm thinking there must have been some kind of story where somebody did that exact thing, where they had the Joker have to help Batman in some way. At the end of the story, maybe not so much. Is there somebody building on that? I heard some voices.
No, there's a lot of ambient noise, but I think there's another question, two more questions, three more questions. Okay, why don't you go first?
Hello, my name is Hakim, I'm 26, and I'm a draftsman, and I love character design. So I know that there is a relation between the writer and the character designer. So my question is, what the writer expecting from the character designer? Is it showing the emotion of the character, or maybe the shape of the character? And also my question is how you could make an iconic character like the Punisher and Daredevil?
Great questions. I think the relationship between the writer and the designer, the character designer, the artist, is, to me, again, always mutual. It's always collaborative. There has to be, the writer may have taken the first pass at a story and described a character in some detail, or character design in some detail. The artist is going to come back with something, and then I think there needs to be a mutual discussion of wow, that's amazing. Sometimes that's it out of the gate, but I think there is, you know, generally a little bit of back and forth to make sure that it fits the needs of the story. Where does the story need to go? To go back to that Daredevil black armor, you know, that you saw before, which was designed by an artist named Scott McDaniel that I worked with. Scott did many designs of that costume, of that armor, before we decided on that one for various reasons and made some modifications. But the design of it, the iconic design of it, you know, came out of the needs of the story. Daredevil needed something that was stronger and more versatile and more resistant to being damaged by villains. So I think you always want the look to fit the story, not just to have, wow, this looks crazy good, but does it fit the story of where it's going? And in terms of creating something very iconic, like the Punisher, as a graphic design thinker, you know, perhaps, you know, what you should be doing is looking at, you know, some of the most famous iconographic designs in the world. You know, what are the buildings that stand out? What are the business logos that stand out? You know, what are the qualities of them? You're not going to put a, you know, that make them different and that make them indelible, so that audiences around the world have seen these, not just in the superhero world, but in all of, you know, advertising and such, because then you can bring that into the superhero world by using those other influences for things that have stood the test of time.
All right, so we're almost out of time, but I do want to make sure that, Dan, do you have a hard stop at 12, or if we run a few minutes over, are you okay?
Yeah, we can go a few minutes over. Let's get all the questions answered if we can.
A question right here in the front? I think we, and then I have a question over here. You have the microphone?
Yeah.
Oh, two questions over here. Okay.
Hello, my name is Hisham. I am 20 years old. I firstly want to thank you for your visit. It's brilliant. It's amazing. I enjoyed my time so much. Thank you for sharing
awesome.
Your experience. Yeah, my question is, have you had any impact on the Netflix series? And if yes, what was it like? yeah, the Netflix adaptation of Daredevil. Yeah, thank you.
Right, right.
Good question.
I think my biggest impact on the Netflix series may have been as a Netflix subscriber. I've given them several hundred dollars over a number of years. I have not had a direct influence on it. Buddy was nice enough to say maybe it picked up on some aspects of some of the stories that I've done. That may be the case. I think when you finally saw his costume that came forward, while it did not look like that black armor costume, it was more resistant to damage. You know, it wasn't the traditional Daredevil one suit, spandex, clean lines. It had reinforced panels. It had reinforced areas on it to protect him as he went into battle. So I do not know for a fact if the writers and creators, you know, looked at the work that Scott McDaniel and I did, but certainly I think they came at it from the same direction of what we were thinking about at the time. And that would be cool if that was actually, the case, but beyond that, I can't claim any credits on the Netflix.
Come on, Dan. They definitely read your comics. We have time for two more quick questions. This person here, all right, three. This person here, and then we had one over here. So three quick questions, because I know, Dan, you are at a day job as well. So
I am.
You are.
Hey, first and foremost, thank you for Mr. Dan for his presence and for sharing his so much information. I want to address a question, like, for me, as a beginner artist, what are you looking for in someone's portfolio when you're taking a look at it? Like, if you may, please give a, step-by-step answer, please. Thank you, sir.
Yes, absolutely. And I'll answer this as both an editor and a writer, and Sean, I'm sure, has a point of view on this as well. But the first and most important thing I'm going to look at is storytelling. If you show me the greatest pinups in the world, you know, hero shots, character shots, wow, those are exciting and I love it. I want to see that you can tell a story. If you cannot tell a story, and by that my eye is cleanly following, you know, something across one page, several pages, you know, with incidents that include not just big action, you know, somebody hitting each other and like, you know, in car crashes or explosions and such, but also maybe a quiet moment. How do characters interact with each other when they're just in a conversational setting? Do you sit them just down at a table and I'm looking at them sitting there and they're sitting at a table for 15 panels? Or do you find ways to kind of move things around, that table so that you're creating some interest in keeping the reader going? These are the things I'm going to look for. There's a famous graphic. Is it Wally Woods?
Wally Woods.
Buddy, you know, yep. Wally Woods 26 or something panels or shots that always work. See if you can find this on Google, you will. And these shots are the close-ups, the long shots, the dramatic angles that you want to start to think about. You show those to an editor or a writer in your sample portfolio pages, and you've worked hard to make those work. Those are going to be the key that's going to open the door for you.
Great question. All right, we're about to wrap. There's one and two. I'm not sure who one is. I think it's, yep, raise your hand. No, it was the person behind there. Thank you, sorry. Dan, we know we got to go. Go.
Hello, my name is Ashraf, and I'm 18 years old. So we're all excited about the next big releases of Marvel, and I'm a great Marvel fan. And one of them is the Avengers Secret Wars, and certainly there will be one of your rotten characters in it. So do we have any idea or any legal leaks for us today?
Good question.
You're talking about the movie, right?
Want you to leak the movie. Anything?
Well, here's all the details. No. I wish I knew. I wish I could say. I would say that, you know, the way that they're working on them and what they've said so far, it certainly seems like they want everybody in it. So I would hope Daredevil also gets a chance to work alongside the Avengers there as much as anybody. But it sounds like they're retooling a lot of things based upon the way that Marvel's approaching their rethinking of of how they want their movies to perform and who the villains and such are going to be. So I think there's a lot of surprises, not just for us as an audience, but for Marvel as creators right now. So stay tuned.
All right, Dan. Yeah, you can clap for that. Dan, there's a whole bunch of other questions, but we're going to do one more and then we're going to wrap because we do have to respectful of your time. Microphone's not on.
It's okay, it works. Yeah, thank you. Hi, everyone. My name is Wafa, and I'm here with my son, who is 10 years old. I'm 14, and we are both big fans of the Marvel movies. So we consume every single film and series from Disney. So my question is more about Marvel Studio, because why women characters are not famous and successful as men characters? For example, She-Hulk, Black Widow, I don't know, Captain Marvel, they are okay, they are good, but they are not as successful and famous as Iron Man, Captain America, and so on. Is it because the industry is more, the writer and so on, are more dominated by men than women in the industry? Mm-hmm. This is why the woman characters are not as famous and successful than men characters.
Good question.
Thank you.
Dan?
You know, to me, all those characters are fantastic characters, right? You know, so when I look at them as a creator and as a writer, I'm excited. I would be excited to work on them. I've worked on some Black Widow stories in my past, and you know, she's just thrilling to work on. I mean, if I had to analyze it, because I liked She-Hulk a lot. I like Captain Marvel a lot. I haven't seen the new one yet, but will. You know, all of them are exciting to me. I wonder if it's, I mean, there's lots of people who will say one thing or another. I wonder if it's because they're coming in later in the mix of things. Like, there's so much Marvel stuff going on right now. You know, is it as easy to get a higher profile on them? But I think that they're all really well done, and that they're all giving, you know, using the female characters in a strong way that's representing them really well. Why they're not as popular, that may be just because there's just so much Marvel stuff right now that it's become hard to sort of focus on it. But they're all incredible characters, and they deserve all the attention and all the fandom that they possibly can get. They're certainly not lesser characters or second tier characters because they're female. I think you'll find any creator who's worked on them always wants to treat them as A-list as possible.
Awesome. Thank you. That was a great question. All right, Dan, we're going to do two things. One, we're going to ask you for, first, your final thoughts, and second, where they can find you. There were some very nice people who had to put their questions to the side because we do have a hard stop. So, wait, but you know what, Sean, before we do that, do you think we can get everybody to just yell really loud, "Thanks, Dan"? Would you guys do that with me? On three, one, three, we're going to say, "Thanks, Dan." One, two, three.
Thanks, Dan.
Oh, yeah, you reached his heart. So, Dan, final thoughts and where they can reach you, especially for those who still have questions for you.
Yeah, folks, thank you so much for your attention and your questions. To be on the other side of the world, literally, with you, and recognize fandom and readers and fellow, you know, just people who are excited about comics. I'm so touched and so grateful for this opportunity. This is even more exciting than I thought it was going to be, buddy. So I'm totally blown away by this. I'm on Instagram and Twitter, at DG Chichester, no periods, just DG Chichester. I'm responsive on either one of those. I would, you know, if you've got a message you want to send me, you want to say hi there, you want to follow as I'm talking about this new Daredevil series, you know, just contact me that way. If you've got a question that didn't get answered here and I can answer it, I will certainly respond, you know, to anybody who wants to reach out and wants to, you know, stay in touch that way. Let's start with those two.
All right. And, in about a week, what is it, a week or 2 weeks, the new issue comes out?
Less than a week. It's next Wednesday.
All right. In less than a week, Dan Chichester's first Daredevil issue is coming out and hit the stands. Are you guys all going to buy that? No, no, no. Louder so Dan can hear you in New York. Are you guys going to buy his issue of Daredevil?
Yes!
All right, Dan, you got some extra sales out of that. Big round of applause for Dan, DG Chichester. Thank you so much.
Folks.
All right, so.
All right.
Goodbye,
Take
Dan.
Take care. Be
All right,
well,
guys.
Bye-bye.
How was that? Was that super fun? Yeah, that was fun. All right, so. We will be having additional guests tomorrow, Sean. We have got a packed schedule. We're going to be sharing more art, more stories. Do we know who is going on tomorrow?
Bob Layton.
Bob Layton, world famous writer, artist on Iron Man, right?
Most known for Iron Man. Editor-in-chief of Valiant Comics. My mentor and also adoptive father.
So thanks to all of you guys for joining us. Thank you to Ayub and the ministry and the council for the arts. Big round of applause for everybody who asked questions. We will see you guys tomorrow.